Hi folks, this is Jason, and I hope you are okay today. This is a public lecture on the Christology of Karl Barth, and I hope this is a blessing to you. This lecture will not be a normal way of expounding Karl Barth. We shall try a new method, a method that is growing among some academics. That method is to go behind what Barth says. Every theologian has a context. If we understood the intellectual and cultural context of Barth, it will shed great light on his Christology. This lecture will be in six parts. Barth in context, Barth third, testing the foundations, fourth, living under the shadow of Kant, five, three Reformed theologians, and then six, Barth on Barth. Barth in context, his intellectual development and theology in general. Barth was born in 1886. He was brought up in a God-fearing family. In his student days, Barth went to study at Marburg and Tübingen. At this time, about 1909, there was a great intellectual rest in Europe. Expressionism was a sign of the times, a revolt against a Philistine culture. Barth writes, quote, "We find ourselves in a deep disaffection with everything hereafter." End of quote. The thinkers who influenced Barth in his student days were Cohen and Wilhelm Hermann. Cohen was a philosopher who saw God as important to fill the gaps. Hermann was much more important to Barth's development and influence in his Christology. As a true Kantian, Hermann thought religion was independent of science. Hermann also had a deep-seated dislike of natural theology. Hermann's epistemology started with God, and he was a despiser of historical relativism. By 1913, Barth was now a pastor. He began to preach on God's wrath. He was much involved in socialist activities, but already Barth was growing as a theologian. He reacted against his peers who signed the manifesto backing the German government. He was developing his epistemology, trying to make God the ground of knowledge to the knower. From 1915 to 1920, Barth's dialectical method was in full swing. Quote, "Barth's theological development from this point on represented a single theme, God is God." End of quote, McGormack. This epistemology was also influenced by his brother Henrik Barth, 1890 to 1965. Quote, "God, not essence, but pure utsprung of everything that is." End of quote, McGormack. By the time Barth had written Romans, he was influenced by Franz Overbeck, 1837 to 1905. He began to see the incarnation as a divine possibility. Kant's philosophy he still took for granted. Quote, "Barth was anti-metaphysical in character," end of quote, McGormack. But Barth's Christology was not at all well developed until after he started lecturing at Göttingen in 1924. His first attempts at Christology were in relation to Revelation. Quote, "It would be more accurate to Barth's intentions to say that Jesus of Nazareth standing on the plane of history is not even the medium of Revelation. As a historical figure, Jesus is the veil of Revelation, but no more than that." End of quote, McGormack. Quote, it means that the new world touches the old world at a single point without extension along the line of historical time. End of quote. The veiling and unveiling ideas Barth kept throughout his theological development, but his time and eternity apparatus he did not take seriously. He now began to ground his theology more in Christology, using Reformed dogmaticus as a basis. Quote, "Before turning to Barth's interpretation of the Incarnation, it should be noted that in presupposing the self-revelation of God in Jesus Christ, Barth was placing the Orthodox Christology of the 16th century on entirely new formation." End of quote. McGormack. Quote, "What is in view is a unity in different action, a strictly dialectical union, which nowhere sets aside the qualitative distinction." By 1925-30, Barth never went back on his general idea of the presence of God. and the veil of creaturely flesh being a presence in reality that is different from God. The only difference now, as from his early days, Barth now saw the whole of Christ's life as significant, not just the cross and the resurrection. Also at this time, Barth was not happy with Brunner's apologetics. As for Barth, Buchan, Anselm, he did not change his Christology significantly. This is just a skeleton of some key developments in Barth's thinking. Some of Barth's overall theology are as follows. Number one, hermeneutics. Secular culture must not be allowed to bring its tools and impose itself on the text. Number two, revelation, God's words and existential act. Number three, theology is a worshipping of God with our whole mind so we might enjoy him and bring glory to him. Four, God is a bringer of knowledge to the knower. The knower has in no ability, the knower has no ability to know God. 5. Christological thinking tells us let God be God. Next, Barth's Christology. In Barth's Göttingen lectures, Barth says we can never take God's place. God is a living God. God can do all things. Barth says that no person can do what God does, that is, become an object perceptible to others. God is the only one that can make himself known. Next, he says that God must use a person, a real person, but conceal himself. God must not be a direct revealer. God must truly meet man, so that Jesus must be a literal human, not an angel or a phantom. Next, Barth says that deity and humanity must be united, but they must not be mixed into each other. Quote, loose inasmuch as the deity does not pass into the humanity, or the humanity become identical with deity. It must be strictly dialectical union. The deity and humanity must be distinguished in such a way that we cannot detract the one from the other. End of quote. Barth then goes on to say that the deity must not be above the humanity of Jesus. The incarnation must be seen as one for all event. The next points out that the incarnation is the objective possibility of revelation. But it's the end of Jesus' life that has more significance for Christology. The traditional view here that history is important for Christology is left behind. The Bible for Barth is not closed revelation, but others outside the Bible could receive revelation. For Barth, indirect communication equals God's incarnation. Barth then points out that Jesus, the man, is God himself, who reveals God himself, that becomes man. This point he makes clear, then he notes that we have to remember that there is depth in God beyond the incarnation. For Barth, the incarnation is the answer to man's contradictory existence. He states this position so dazzling here, quote, it is not a changing of the divine nature of the Son, but with his divine mode of existence, the Son takes a human mode of existence, uniting it, the grace of union, to his person, just as the divine mode of existence is eternally united to his person, yet without any way altering his divine mode of existence. End of quote. Page 156. Quote, that was Karl Barth. Not, quote again, not the deity become man, but the Son, although naturally without ceasing to be who he is, and therein, and with his entire deity, in contrast to the human nature that the Son assumes and unites to his person, is the persons, the substance of man, his being as a body and soul, with all the limitations of the limitations this means. End of quote. Karl Barth. Quote, the Logos in Christ's flesh and the Logos outside Christ's flesh are naturally not two different entities, the one a revealing part of the Logos and the other a part that remains hidden. Quote, end of quote. Bromley, page 25. Barth's view changed a little in his life. In his Christology, in the dogmatics expounded in John 1:14, we have the following teaching. Number one, Word is very God. The Word is subject of what happens. The Word acts in divine freedom. The Word does not stop to be free or sovereign in becoming flesh. If God is the subject, then Mother of God idea is correct, but Mariology is to be rejected. A true humanity, his flesh participates in all the human nature or essence. He is reckoned a sinner on our behalf, flesh denotes likeness, it points to sinless life and obedience. End of quote. Bromley, page 25. When in the Bible text it says become, Barth insists it does not mean surrender of being as the word. That is why Barth liked to use the word assumed, as it protected the integrity of the word. Barth kept up his love of seeing Jesus as the concrete existence that makes history real and reveals God. Quote, the heart of the object of Christian faith is the word of the action which God from all eternity willed to become man in Jesus Christ. End of quote. Barth Dogmatics Outline, page 65. Testing the foundations, McGrath and Hart. What was Barth trying to do in his Christology? Barth to free theology from culture. He writes, quote, page 31, McGrath. For Barth, the recognition that God revealed himself as Lord in Jesus Christ was the means by which theology could be freed from the baleful influence of culture, anthropology, metaphysical, allowing it initially to become emancipated from its cultural matrix and subsequently to develop and maintain its intellectual autonomy. End of quote. This helps us to start on a critical assessment of Barth's Christology. In my reading of his lectures on Göttingen, the dogmatics in outline and other pieces, one is actually aware how abstract Barth's Christology is. It is totally unrelated to the world he wrote in. When he writes about the man Jesus, it is never in the context of how he relates to man in the 20th century, and most certainly not to specific life situations. This lack of bringing Christology into reflection with the culture of the day stifles debate and development. Quote, to detach oneself from a tradition is to impede the process of understanding which takes place within precisely such a tradition. End of quote. McGrath, page 34. The next problem we have with Barth's Christology is he tried to minimize the importance of history in its classical sense. History for him was not a sure basis to construct theology. In a sense, Barth wants us to receive Christ as a possibility without data. I think this means the word does not really become flesh in space-time, but hovers over flesh in the recipient of faith. Quote, if Barth's logos truly became sarx, the particular way in which the becoming or the union between the two is consistently construed in his theology, nonetheless risk reducing it to the point where it loses all purchase in the real world, thereby robbing it of genuine redemptive and revelatory substance. End of quote. It has also been noted that Barth tried to deal with Fehrenbach's accusation against 19th century theology, which was too anthropological. Barth's Göttingen Christology was trying to give religious knowledge objectivity, but his putting the doctrine of Christology with revelation does not achieve objectivity and weakens the foundations of Christology proper. The antithesis and thesis of Word and God will not lead to synthesis of dialectical union of the person of Christ, precisely because it's only a possibility, and possibility does not make for objective reality. Barth's Christology is also weakened by the ideas of veiling and unveiling of God. That is, God reveals himself in history, but not real history. It might use concrete language, but Barth is really only saying that the divine only touches the man Christ. This might seem to contradict Barth's ideas on sacrifice on the surface of his teaching, but Barth held tenaciously to the veiling theology, which comes out strongly at Göttingen, but less so in his dogmatics. Quote, Barth's own terms, by mistaking the veil of the flesh for that which it veils, such approaches fail to inquire into what really matters and shut themselves off from the possibility of the veil becoming an open door. End of quote. Next point, living under the shadow of Kant. As the young lecturer thundered his theology at Göttingen, he was a John the Baptist crying in the wilderness of liberal theology, a theology sunk in the sand of a subjectivity. Barth, with all his brilliance, was going to put the West back on objective theological rock, but as he was doing his theology, just as the liberals lived under the shadow of Kant's philosophy, so he did the same. Barth's whole Christology, with a touch of Occam thrown in. Occam believed God by his power can make us have intuitive knowledge of an object that does not exist. My contention is then that Barth lived under the shadow of Kant. Kant tried to show that religion had nothing to fear from science because reason, scientifically considered, could not verify religious statements. This is why Barth says the subject cannot know, but the object can make the subject know. The whole of Barth's Christology is founded on this. What has happened is objective verification of facts for religion has been destroyed. The historical Christ then is non-verifiable. If Barth would have taken on Neo-Kantian philosophy and not accepted it, then his Christology would have been better off than Kant. He would have been optimistic about human nature, skeptical of Prussian morality. Sorry, I'll do that again. If Barth would have taken on Neo-Kantian philosophy and not accepted it, then his Christology would have been better off. Kant, optimistic about human nature, skeptical about knowledge, full of Prussian morality, failed to even think that God could work through history. It is at this point Kant and Barth fail to see the strategic importance of having a Christ rooted in verifiable historical data. Quote, instead of asking how our knowledge can conform to its object, we must start from the supposition that objects must conform to our knowledge. Quote, Kenny, page 252. Reformed theologians. I shall now use three theologians to help me be critical of Barth. These Reformed theologians have their blind spots. They are not too narrow at times, and they only interact with their own faith community. They are locked, in my opinion, to Hamilton's common sense philosophy. Charles Hodge points out in his systematic theology that Christ's incarnation does not mean that one nature participates in the attributes of the other. No, but rather that the person is the partaker of the attributes of both natures. This means that whatever may be affirmed of their nature, well, it may be affirmed of the person. Now, granted that Barth uses the word assumed in his Christology, it is still true because of his veiling ideas to say that Barth's God enters the world and is present within a hypostatically while yet remaining utterly distinct from it by nature. So the old orthodox view of Hodge's hypostatic union and two natures, the sharing of attributes, is simply destroyed. If this is a good point, I don't know, but Barth's view is really, in reality, two natures, no union. Hodge, page 392. I understand this cuts across much of Barthian scholarship. I must take this point further. I think that Barth was clear on the issue of the two natures, but on the union, not so. He was using a dialectical method. The Son of God is in eternity, came down to earth, was a dialectical tool. He was using language of orthodoxy as a vehicle for his dialectical program, in my view. His hypostatic union was a dialectical code, not a real divine being. He wanted to bridge the gap between the finite and the infinite, but there was no middle ground. This dialecticism, Van Til notes, quote, it is therefore in line with Berkauer's criticism to say that mutually exclusive view of Scripture involved two mutually exclusive views of God and man, and only the Christ of Scripture rather than the Christ of Barth can save us from monism. End of quote. Van Til, page 135. In my opinion, Barth was in truth more scholastic than reformational. Barth built his Christology on a philosophical basis. It has great strengths in that it gives preeminence to God, but it has great weaknesses that it gets the main points of orthodoxy. It gets the main points of orthodoxy, but penetrates it with over-philosophizing the analogy of faith. Keeping to the Bible in reformational sense would have its problems, but it would help to avoid over-speculation, which Barth indulges in. Barth on Barth. Conclusion. The conclusions of this lecture are as follows. Barth's Christology was generally the same throughout his career, influenced by his veiling of God idea and Neo-Kantianism. 2. Barth's Christology was essentially orthodox on the surface, but realism, it was strong on the hypostatic It was strong on hypostatic union. The foundations of Barth's Christology were shaky because it failed to interact with culture, it minimized the real history of Jesus, it mixed veiling philosophy with his Christology. 4. Barth was not critical of Kant enough, he never thought, as the Ritchielians did, that real history could be verified. This means Jesus' life was open to investigation, which means real knowledge of God would be obtained. The God is God of Barth was not satisfactory, as it was not grounded in verifiable historical data. 5. This means for all Barth's talk that the Son assumed flesh, it was but a dialectical tool. He never really bridged the gap between the God-man. In the end, Barth's Christology is a scholastic speculation, grand in scope, dazzling in its intellectual flawed at the historical point above. It is this point of not grounding his Christology in real history that causes problems for Barth's theology, but Barth will have none of it. Barth's letter, page 168. I wrestle in vain, says Barth, with the question by what right you manage to wrest the doctrine of the revelation of God enacted in Jesus, indeed the very existence and life of God in Jesus, identity with him, on the basis of the figure of your historical Jesus and his message and commitment to God, confirmed by his resurrection from the dead. End of quote. Panningbird replied in this letter below, I agree with what it says. It also is a good summary of what I have tried to establish. End quote. Barth Letters, page 350. It has been my concern not to begin with the generality of soteriological anthropological of God-man unity, but rather with a highly particular and unique fact of the historical events of Jesus of Nazareth. End of quote. Okay, these are the references for this lecture. Karl Barth, Dogmatics in Outline, SCM, London, 1949. Karl Barth, The Gottingen Dogmatics, Volume 1, Erdmann's Grand Rapids, 1990. Karl Barth's Letters, 1961-68, T&T Clark, Edinburgh, 1981. J. Bowden, Karl Barth, SCM Books, London, 1971. Introduction to the Theology of Karl Barth, T&T Clark, Edinburgh, 1979, G. Bromley. T. Hart, Regarding Karl Barth, Paternoster Press, London, 1999. C. Hodge, Systematic Theology, Volume 2, Erdmann's Grand Rapids, 1901-1901, republished 1993. Mr. Press, 1986. A. Kenny, A Brief History of Western Philosophy, Blackwell, Massachusetts, 1998. A. McGrath, Reckoning with Barth, Mowbray, London, 1998. B. McGormack, Karl Barth, Critically Realist Dialectical Theology, Clarendon Press, Oxford, 1997. T. Torrance, Karl Barth, Biblical and Evangelical Theologian, T&T Clark, Edinburgh, 1990. C. Van Til, Christianity and Barthianism, The Presbyterian and Reformed Publishing Company, Philadelphia, 1962. And B. Warfield, Christology and Criticism, Baker Book House, Grand Rapids, 1929. On Karl Barth's scholarship, I would recommend three books to read out of all those. I would recommend B. McGormack's Karl Barth, Critical Realist Dialectical Theology, Clarendon Press, Oxford, 1997. Books ever written on Karl Barth's intellectual development. In fact, I think it's one of the best books ever written on Karl Barth. T. Torrance, Karl Barth, Biblical and Evangelical Theologian, was an expert in Karl Barth, and so I would recommend that you look at him. And from a conservative reform position, Cornelius Van Til, Christianity and Barthianism, is a book that will give you the conservative evangelical. Just to note, the C. Tanville Cornelius Van Til position on Karl Barth is a small minority in the academic world when it comes to Barthian scholarship. But What a lot of Barthian scholars don't realize is that Cornelius Van Til was an expert on Karl Barth. Van Til read all of Barth's dogmatics. So when he writes on Barth, he's writing from a very authoritative position. But Cornelius Van Til's scholarship on Barth was ignored by the academic world of Barthian scholars. And that's an injustice and unfair. But B. McCormack, Karl Barth, Critical Realist Dialectical Theology is an absolutely brilliant book. Torrance, T. Torrance on Karl Barth was an expert, and C. Van Til is an expert from a more reformed evangelical point of view. There are two lectures that you can go and listen to by Francis Schaeffer at Labrie Fellowship on Karl Barth on Neo-Orthodoxy. So if you want to look at Karl Barth's theology, Neo-Orthodoxy by Francis Schaeffer is two excellent lectures that will help you to think through this issue. Also, theological seminary, there is a department on Karl Barth there with research material. If you want to do essays and academic research, I think that's perhaps the best place in the world to go to do a PhD or do research on Karl Barth, because they have a big reputation at Princeton of having a department on Karl Barth. So I hope that's helped to you, and hope it will help you and stimulate you in studying the theology of Karl Barth. Thank you for listening, and God bless you.